Now let's take a look at classifying costs in a way that helps us predict cost behavior. We'll first need to discuss just a few terms. Cost structure refers to the relative proportion of each type of cost in an organization. Generally speaking, this means that we are looking at variable costs versus fixed costs. Now you've probably heard of those terms before. We'll discuss them in just a few minutes. Cost behavior. This refers to how a cost will react to changes in the level of activity. An example of this would be, will a cost increase, decrease, or remain constant if we produce more units? Understanding cost behavior will help managers with their roles in planning and controlling the organization. An activity base, also called a cost driver, is a measure of what causes a variable cost to change, or the variable portion of a cost. Examples of cost drivers might be units produced, units sold, direct labor hours, number of customers, etc. There are all kinds of activity bases that you will see that will drive how a cost behaves. The relevant range is where a firm finds it practical to operate in the short run. Think in terms of a company may want to operate in the short run at a production level of 5 to 10,000 units a month. If they go above 10,000 units of production, perhaps they'll need more space, more equipment, another manager. But if they go below 5,000 units, they have too much space, too many managers, and so they will need to reduce those costs. Now, how this relates to cost behavior is this is where we can assume our assumptions about cost behavior are valid. This is a very short range of activity with a short run focus, usually a year or less. And so what we find is that some costs, if you go outside the relevant range, you really cannot estimate them correctly, and they don't necessarily remain constant. For example, rent. If you need more facilities, you will have more rent. Now, this relevant range of activity does pertain to both fixed and variable costs. Variable costs that could change with activity would be if you get a purchase discount if you purchase above a certain level. So we're going to hold our discussions to a very short range of activity, and we can hold our definitions true. We will classify costs in three ways. Variable cost, this is one that varies in total, directly and proportionately with activity. So when we say varies in total, that of course means that the total amount will change, but directly and proportionally means if activity increases 10%, cost will increase 10%. Examples, direct material would increase 10% if we produce 10% more units. Likewise, direct labor costs will vary directly with activity. Sales commissions. Now, to demonstrate the behavior of the variable cost, let's assume Rhino Expeditions orders a meal for each customer who books an expedition. The caterer charges Rhino $20 per meal day provided. We'll look at four levels of activity. We'll look at if 250 guests go on an excursion, 500 guests, 750 guests, and 1,000 guests. Notice that the caterer will charge $20 per meal day regardless of the activity within this range of activity. So the meal cost per guest remains constant at $20. The total meal cost will be $5,000 if 250 guests go on an excursion, and $10,000 if we double our number of guests to 500. So notice that the activity doubled and the total cost doubled. At 750 guests, $15,000 of cost, and 1,000 guests, $20,000 of cost. Now, this chart, while the math is very simple, demonstrates two important characteristics about a variable cost. First, in total, it varies in direct proportion to activity. Second, the per unit amount remains constant within this relevant range. Next up, fixed costs. These remain constant in total regardless of the changes in the activity level. An example might be rent or salaries. Again, we'll look at Rhino Expeditions. The company pays $500 per month to rent space for storage of equipment. We'll once again look at the same four activity levels ranging from 250 guests to 1,000 guests. And what you'll notice here is that it is the total that does not change. We will pay $500 whether 250 guests, 500 guests, 750 guests, or 1,000 guests are taken on an excursion. But because that numerator stays the same, the average cost per unit will change. At 250 guests, it's $2 per unit. At 500 guests, it's $1 per unit. At 750 guests, it goes to 67 cents a unit, and at 1,000 guests, 50 cents per guest. All right, the chart above demonstrates two characteristics about fixed costs. First, the total remains constant as activity changes. But secondly, fixed cost per unit varies inversely with activity. Every time an additional guest is taken on an excursion, the cost per unit or cost per guest will change. So when we say varies inversely, what we mean is if activity increases, the cost per unit decreases. It is important to distinguish in the planning that there are committed fixed costs and discretionary fixed costs. The committed fixed costs are difficult to change in the short run without impairing ability to operate. Executive salaries, facilities costs, your rent on your current manufacturing plant, your property taxes on your administrative building, those are difficult to change in the short run without impairing your ability to operate. Now, discretionary fixed costs usually arise from annual decisions. They can be modified before you sign a contract. So in planning, these are called managed or discretionary fixed costs, and they include things that will not have immediate damage to current operations. Examples would be training programs. We could go from a one-week training program to a three-day training program. Advertising, research and development. In the short run, you can still operate as planned. Now, in the long run, of course, this could have an impact, but in the short run, we can reduce these costs. Mixed cost. This is our third type of cost, and it contains both a variable and a fixed component. It's also called a semi-variable cost. An example would be your utility bill. If you did not use any electricity, you would still get a bill. You would have a sanitation fee and other fees that will be charged regardless of the level of activity. Now let's assume Rhino Expeditions must pay a license fee to the state of $25,000 per year for its annual license, plus $3 per party taken on an excursion. You'll notice that the fixed portion of the license fee is constant, regardless of the level of activity, and the variable portion of the bill varies in total in direct proportion to the level of activity. We will be able to use the equation for a line to calculate the total mixed cost. An equation for a line is y equal mx plus b. And if we put that in terms of the total cost, variable cost per unit of activity times activity, that will be our total variable cost and we add our total fixed cost to get our total cost. What is the total license fee if 1,000 parties are taken on the excursion? And of course, that would be the fixed cost of $25,000 plus the variable cost of $3 per excursion times 1,000 excursions, or $28,000. Eventually, we'll see that mixed costs will need to be broken into their fixed and variable components. We will ultimately want to know what our total variable costs are and what our variable cost per unit is, but we'll discuss that later in the course. All right, concept check. If Rhino Expeditions incurs equipment maintenance expense of $500 when 250 guests are served and $800 when 500 guests are served, what type of cost is maintenance expense? To understand this, recognize that we would want to know what happens to the cost in total. It goes from 500 to 800, so it does change. And we would want to know the cost per unit. At 250 guests, the $500 maintenance cost would be $2 per unit. But for 500 guests, $800 divided by 500 guests, it's $1.60 per unit. So what we see is that the total cost is not constant, therefore it's not a fixed cost, and the per unit cost is not constant. Therefore, it is not a purely variable cost. Yes, the cost does vary, but it's not classified as a purely variable cost. It would be classified as a mixed cost. All right, again, eventually these mixed costs will need to be broken into their fixed and variable elements. We'll learn how to do that later. But for now, you want to understand the definition of a variable cost, a fixed cost, and a mixed cost, and how that affects the total cost. All right, well, stay tuned. We're going to work an example to try to put all of this together.